Music money makers, many new acts don't really know what they're selling and why they're selling this stuff. Record companies may seem a little backwards when it comes to their deals, but they don't really explain the job of the artist and what the artist is supposed to do based on that contract. Now, this is confusing because everybody's talking about their masters and they're saying, oh, the record company's evil and all this, that, and the third. And though that kind of might be the case, you still need to be aware of what's actually going on. Now, the strange illogical conclusion here, this paradox, if you will, is that the artist should not only be worried about what they're doing or what they're getting paid for, but it should be what they're actually selling. And this is the main reason why I feel like a lot of artists don't understand what's happening with their contracts or in the music game today. Now, this can be very hard to see from the outside if you've never been in it or if you've never been through a contract or never tried to enact or execute on one of these contracts. I get that. And this is what we're going to crack open in today's episode of the Music Money Makeover Show. Hey, Music Money Makers, welcome back to the show. You can clearly see we have the widescreen thing going on here. It is back. I also brought back the slides. Tell me how you like it. But just how we're going to rock out today. So let's go ahead and hop into the show. We're going to kick things off with Will.i.am.
The dirty little secret is that very, very few artists actually made a really healthy living selling records in the history of the music industry. Because people forgot that the music industry was always technology. Like, people forgot that RCA was technology that Americans used in World War I and II. And then RCA became a consumer product and then bought Victor's talking machine. And it also became our radio. And it's also the reason why artists don't get paid terrestrial radio rights in America, because it was always the lost leader.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that, Will.i.am. It's funny that we have to bring RCA into the picture here, because RCA is the culprit for which we need to talk about why artists don't have certain things, okay? So you're gonna see how this is gonna unfold here. So who is RCA and what does RCA do? Okay, well, RCA is the Radio Corporation of America, all right? It was a major electronic company that was founded in 1919. And yes, they were around during World War I and World War II, trying to get it out, okay? So an innovative and progressive company, they were, was the dominant electronics company and communications firm in the United States for over five decades. So, I mean, it's a household brand. And they also created radio receivers and super heterodyne sets. These are old school types of radios, really old school. And they also created the National Broadcasting Company. Well, if I'm a radio company and I'm going to create something that will be broadcasted across the radio, I have to create another company to broadcast some programming here. Well, that seems right. I mean, I'm not faulting them for that. They're a company that has to do that. But then, oh, wait a minute. The rapid rise of radio broadcasting during the early 1920s, which provided unlimited free entertainment in the home, had a detrimental effect on the American phonograph record industry. The Victor Talking Machine Company in Camden, New Jersey, was then the world's largest manufacturer of records and phonographs, including its popular showcase, the Victrola line. They had to make records to sell a couple things. They had to sell a record player. Ultimately, in 1929, RCA purchased the Victor Company, like I just said, and this acquisition became known as the RCA Victor Division of the Radio Corporation of America and included ownership of Victor's Japanese subsidiary, the Victor Company of Japan. You know this as JVC. So they make other CD players, stereo systems, speakers, all of that, in addition to RCA making radio equipment. So all this formed in 1927. And controlling interest in the Gramophone Company Limited, which later became EMI Records, which now belongs to Universal Records. So all of this had to be formed to sell stuff in the beginning. Hence, we would need some type of person to put something on record, to put something on wax. And before I do that, I got to cue Will.i.am one more time.
You have to look at the origins of the music industry being hardware. Our music was made to sell hardware, to the point that if you sold outside of that circle, you were deemed a sellout. A sellout doesn't mean you change your morals. You sold out of the circle of things you were supposed to sell. Phonographs, record players. We could have been signed a Cadillac. There's radios in Cadillac. But That's not what we were supposed to sell.
That's interesting. So the question is, what was recorded music made to sell? It was made to sell this type of technology right here. The radios and the record players, if you will. Okay, recorded music was made to sell phono records, otherwise known as vinyl, CD, cassette tapes, and streaming subscriptions that the major labels get a cut of by being shareholders of companies like Spotify. Now, question is, what do recording artists sell? Recording artists sell recorded reproductions of compositions to the record company and get a 20% cut of the net profits from the sale on average. Whether it's vinyl or streaming, in most cases, all of this money is paid to you via an advance from the record company. I mean, if not in all cases, unless you're independent, this is what's happening. The record company is advancing you all of the money in exchange for a portion of the net proceeds or net profits from the record sold that they get. That's it. As a recording artist, that's all you're getting. You have to add on more skills if you want to make more money. Okay?
Write your own songs. Because publishing was the first music industry. You wrote songs, they printed on sheet music, and you sold pianos, trumpets, violins, violas, tubas, oboes. And people came together to play them, and they sold out Carnegie Halls. And architects built cathedrals and theaters. Music is supposed to build bars, and you were supposed to sell other things with it. Until the music industry figures out what we're going to sell, hardware, then we are just a hired gun to sell somebody else's stuff.
Well, let's talk about music publishing. Music publishers license compositions written by songwriters, known as authors, aka the lyric writer, and composers, aka the music writer, to record companies for reproduction purposes with a recording artist. They also license those same compositions to other sources where they can generate money, i.e. TV, film, commercial advertisements, and social media. So let's break it down. So if I'm a recording artist strictly alone, if I go back to my previous slide, and this is all I'm doing, I'm going in and I'm recording someone else's song, well, all I'm going to get is that advance. But we got to stack on the skills here, which means you need to learn how to write some songs. Well, we're still at the bottom here. I'm going to get into some more things in a minute. All right. But you got to write some songs now, because the song is what's being sold on a reproduction, but not the song itself, to the record company, just the reproduction of it. That means the record label is going to give you a royalty for it. You get what I'm saying? But if you already maxed out your sound or your master royalty, your artist royalty, if you maxed that out in the advance, what else are you going to get money on? So you got to write some songs, possibly. Not always, but possibly. Or you got to get your game plan together. So that's the quickest default. Well, I need to write some songs. All right, cool. We write some songs. We got the publishing. The record company's paying us a royalty. The radio stations are paying us royalties. Spotify, social media sites, they're paying us royalties for the usage of our songs because they're reproducing them. Okay, great. But that doesn't really keep me in the game that long, because it takes so long for publishing money to come in. We got to do something else. So I got to cue another person into the video. I have to cue in Steve Stout. And then I'm going to come back and we're going to cue in Will.i.am again.
If music is going to be the lost leader, which it has become, your goal is to use the music to gain attention and then sell higher margin items, higher margin than music, in order to really cash out. One of those higher margin items is clearly shows, right? You make more money. You can make money doing shows more than actual streams. Other higher margin items are merch. Some higher margin items that are coming out because of technology, but it requires you owning it. Things like NFT and how NFTs are affecting the owner of a copyright or a piece of work. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be more down the line, but it only is going to be beneficiary to the owner.
Yeah.
So as an artist, you want to release as much work as you can, gain an audience, and then start mining all of the higher margin opportunities that are currently present and the ones that are coming out of technology-based solutions.
Yeah.
So artists are supposed to make money when they come up with other things to sell and use their music to sell it. Dr. Dre and Beats, Me and I Am Plus, or going out and selling out venues. You want to sell out? Sell out the Staples Center. You want to make money? Do your own festival.
Let's give it up to Nasir, because Nasir owns his shit now. You know, it's a shame Nas don't own Illmatic. But the facts of the matter is Nas owns his work now. He owns King's Disease. He owns all of his works going forward. He's an example of somebody who said, you know what? I'm not going to take the short money because it's short money. I'm going to bet on myself and own my shit. And then I found higher margin items like Coinbase.
Now, here's the funny thing. Steve, Will, they make all the great points. I've made those points before on this channel before, but I figured I'd bring some social proof into it. And they kept saying this thing called the loss leader. And what is a loss leader? Well, a loss leader strategy involves selling a product or service at a price that is not profitable, but is sold to attract new customers or to sell additional products and services to those customers. Loss leading is a common practice when a business first enters a market. A loss leader introduces new customers to a service or product in the hopes of building a customer base and securing future recurring revenue. This is the whole point of selling the music so low. Well, it's gotten to that point now. They took the CDs away. Technology has advanced itself. Eventually, I can see Spotify starting to spin out by 2032, 33. I can see that. I think YouTube and TikTok will take over the streaming markets. I'm going to say that now. That's what's going to happen. Okay. And so ultimately, this is you right over here. You're this new customer right here. And the music is selling for the cheap, cheap, cheap. And even though you're going to make money from publishing and music, and I'll talk about it in the long run, ultimately, you got to sell it low just to attract new customers to whatever it is you're trying to do. You get what I'm saying? So that's what we got to do here. All right. Now, with that being said, after that, well, what are you supposed to do as a recording artist? You got to sell something so you won't be broke. Old artists back in the day would call you a sellout, but currently this is just the way of the world. So we got to do a live performance. Now that we are recording artists, great. We're really good at recording. And though you can make a lot of money recording or a decent advance, right? You got to stack on the skill of being a songwriter. Great. Well, if you're not a great songwriter, hire some songwriters to write some great songs, but you can be a great performer. The point is, we need a hot record. And if you can't write one, hire somebody to write a hot record for you, but you double down on being a great performer. Because once you start to perform, things start to really, really happen. You create a live experience for people, and then they're going to love you even more than just being the artist that's sitting in the corner and your show sucks and nobody wants to come see you. They love your music, but just you personally as a live performer, you suck. So you got to build the skills up of being a great live performer. Well, what else can you do? Well, you can license those songs that you wrote. You get what I'm saying? While you've already been maxed out on your recording advance, you still got your publishing. This publishing can be licensed. These songs can be licensed for usages in so many other places. You get what I'm saying? Somebody else could do your same exact song. You get what I'm saying? You can sell your own merchandise. You can sell other brands. You get what I mean? This is how you now begin to level up. But if you don't do that, and you can also sell, you can also have your social media content, reality TV based shows on your lifestyle interests. You can also have that too. But if you don't do this stuff, then you end up being the recording artist who says, man, the record company, they put me in debt. And they're going to put you in debt anyway. That's the advance that you're going to get. Your job was to sell other things. And back in the 60s and the 70s, when they said, oh, you're a sellout, they weren't thinking this way. That's where the argument came from. The argument came from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, when they were making so much money on CDs, cassettes, and tapes, and all the physical product, the physical medium to sell music, that you didn't really have to rely on other sources. They would call you a sellout in the 70s when you went and did a commercial for maybe a Colgate or something like that, right? Or you sold another brand. Then it's like, oh, you're selling out. You're not real. You're not keeping it true to the art. Meanwhile, that person is making a lot of money. The person who's sitting there just recording and strictly trying to make money on music is losing. It over time became the loss leader. And because it did, you got to do other stuff, which makes it a lot harder. The barrier of entry into music is a lot easier, but it's easier to go broke if you're still trying to do things like it's 1996. So you can't do it for that reason. You ultimately have to understand that the barrier to entry is low. You must get people in the door, and you must create attention to do so. Once they get in, you can do other stuff. And as long as you understand this, you can begin to build your empire. Now, funny thing is, well, we got a few concerns here. Man, I just wanted to make music. Well, you can make music only. You won't make much money, but at least you will preserve the culture and the art form, and we applaud you for that. You get what I'm saying? Well, thing is, how do I figure out what things would be good for me to sell? That's when you book a call with me. At that point, you got to book a call with me. Because now we have to strategize on what would be good specifically for you. If we don't do that for you, then, you know what I mean? It's kind of not going to do any justice once you start making the music. And you got to take much, 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 much longer to make the music. The music has to go along with everything else that you will begin selling. You get what I mean? All of this is what you may call marketing and branding. Of course, though, you can't brand. The customer has to create, say that the experience was good in order for it to get branding. You may call it social credit or whatever. That's technically what it is. But this is marketing. This is placing you in the market, and therefore we will have to come together to build a strategy for you. Now, here's what I recommend. Grab the 60-day record label below, because what we got to do is we got to build the foundation. We got to build a label. We got to build your publishing division. And all this has to be done so you can skate past that low entry-level bar, and you can start accumulating that money a lot faster than a person who's just trying to wing it and like, oh, I heard to do this. I heard they say do that. I heard they say you should go over here, right? We want to skate past that entry level really fast because we want to get to selling stuff. That's the goal. The longer it takes you to get through that low bar entry gate is the longer it's going to take your career to grow. But if you can fast track all this stuff, and especially the building portion, then we can get to work. And that's what this book is designed to do. Grab a copy of that right there. It's going to really help you a lot. Now, in the end, you'll end up making more money in the long run from your music. You'll have more business knowledge, and you'll profit from the attention that you gain quicker than others due to the fact that you own everything. That's the whole point here. But as I said, if you stick to your guns, if you stick to the fact that you're going to say, okay, we're going to strictly do music only, and that's all that we're going to do, I guarantee you the career will be short-lived because you won't have enough income to sustain what it is you're doing. You'll be that hobbyist. But if you love it, great, man. We appreciate you. However, at least some of this confusion in the beginning about what you're actually doing as a recording artist, why you're having the financial troubles that you're having, were opened up to you, were clarified so you can see, oh, it's not just the music that I need to do. There are other things that I need to sell in order to have some true success in this industry and maybe not lose yourself in this industry as well. All right, music money makers, if you make music, you should always make money. Book a call on musicmoneymakeover.com, download the 60-day record label, and I'll see you next time. Peace.